Welcome back, everybody. So the goal for today is to talk about a technique that sometimes is referred to as partial integration, which we will be using quite heavily in order to calculate the values of double integrals, which we introduced yesterday. So today we're just going to introduce this technique and talk about how that technique is executed. And then as we go forward tomorrow and the next day, we're going to talk about how to actually use this technique to calculate net volumes that we introduced in yesterday's material. So we only have one goal, to use partial integration to calculate something called an iterated double integral. So to set the stage, when you're introduced to these problems, you're going to encounter an expression which has one of two different forms. Format number one is you have a function of two variables, and this is your integrand living in the center. Now, if I move one level out, you're going to see the symbol dx, and you're going to see your first layer of integration. An integral symbol that potentially has a function of y on the bottom and on the top. And then you move out one more layer, and you encounter the symbol dy on your right, and you encounter a second integral symbol which has limits of integration a and b, which are just numbers. Now it's possible that you encounter the order of integration dx dy as you move from the inside to the out, or it's possible that you encounter the order of integration dy dx as you move from the inside out. If you see dy dx, then corresponding to dy, the innermost limits of integration here will be functions of x, function of x. If you see something that looks like one of these two, where there are two dx dy, and there are two separate integral symbols, each with their own limits, something like this is called an iterated integral. Called iterated because it's telling you to take f of xy and integrate it two times. Integrate it once and then iterate and integrate it a second time. And the convention in math usually, and here as well, is that we're going to calculate these integrals from the inside out. And let me show you what I'm talking about with a demonstration. And let's use this particular iterated integral. The integral from 0 to 1, integral from y squared to y, integrand x squared y dx dy. So we need to work from the inside out with these problems. So for the moment, I'm just going to ignore the outermost integral from 0 to 1 dy. And I'm going to focus my attention on the innermost integral y squared to y of x squared y with respect to x. Now, the term partial integration here is similar in spirit to when we were doing partial derivatives. The idea is to integrate x squared y with respect to x, treating y as a constant, Just like we did with partial derivatives, we are going to do here, integrate x squared y with respect to x, treating y as a constant. So, we're still leaving our outermost integral alone, focusing just on the innermost one for right now. Let us find this definite integral of x squared y, pretending that y is just a constant. So if I apply the power rule for integrals, x squared becomes x cubed over 3, and because of the constant multiple rule, the constant multiple y just sort of stays put. Then, we evaluate that antiderivative from y squared, and in particular from x equals y squared to x equals y. Okay, so just as we would with a regular ordinary integral, we're going to go in and plug in these two limits of integration and then subtract the results. So I will plug in x equals y. Y times y cubed over 3. And then I will take away y times, not x, but the lower limit of integration, y squared, and then cube that over 3. And then let's go ahead and let's just simplify this a bit and clean this up. So that's y to the 4th in total over 3. Take away y to the 6th power and then one more, y to the 7th power over 3, dy. All right, now notice, and this is essential, notice x is now gone from this problem. And that is what is supposed to happen. When you finish, the dx integral, x should always be gone. Okay, so now that we've finished the innermost integral and we have eliminated all the x's, let's work on the y's integral. And because all the x's have been completely eliminated, the y's integral is basically just a calculus 2 integral with a single variable function. We apply the power rule. So y to the 5th power over 15 minus y to the 8th power over 24. And then we can plug in the lower and upper limits and subtract the difference. So 0 in both of these terms vanishes, 1 in both of these terms, we get 1 over 15 minus 1 over 24, which is some delightful number that I can't be bothered to actually calculate. But whatever number this is the result of the calculation that we're instructed to do when we see notation like this. Working from inside out, perform partial integration one integral at a time, starting with the innermost integral, dx, so treat y as constant, then x is gone, and then integrate with respect to y. This is the technique called partial integration. So let's try another example, just for the exercise. Let's integrate from negative 2 to 2, and then integrate from 0 to square root x, the integrand x squared y, dx. Now it's the same integrand as last time, but not only have the limits of integration changed, the order of integration has changed this time as well. So where previously dx was on the inside and dy was on the outside, now we have dy on the inside. So we're going to take the dx integral and we're just going to sort of ignore it for a little while. And we're going to focus on integrating from 0 to square root x, the integrand x squared y with respect to y. And this time, to calculate the dy integral, we're going to pretend that x is constant. All right, so let's find an antiderivative of x squared y with respect to y, pretending that x is constant. And once again, our outermost integral just gets ignored, just gets sort of set to the side. So applying the power rule and the constant multiple rule for integrals, the constant multiple x squared just gets left alone, just stays put. And the antiderivative of y with respect to y by power rule is y squared over 2. And this can be evaluated from the lower limit of y equals 0 to y equals square root 2. I should probably get that battery situation sorted. Okay, now that we have plugged in the tablet, let's continue. So, let's plug in the upper limit of x equals square root, y equals square root x, the lower limit of y equals 0, and subtract the two results. Here still is our outermost limit, which is being ignored for a little while. And then we plug in for y, the quantity square root x in the upper limit. And we plug in for y, the quantity 0 in the upper limit. And let's clean that up. So we have the integral now from negative 2 to 2. X squared times x, in total 3 x's. And in the back, since we're multiplying by 0, that just vanishes. And notice once again, the dy integral is complete. And as a result, we have no more y's. And that should happen every single time. Once you finish the dx integral, all the x's should be gone. And once you finish the dy integral, all of the y's should be gone as well. All right. Finally, let's integrate this nice, clean polynomial function with respect to x by power rule. Negative 2 to 2. And because of the evenness of this function, we have 16 over x minus 16 over 8, which is 0, is the result of this double integral. All right, this is the method of partial integration, working from the inside out. Now, to this point, you have been calculating double integrals that I have given to you. But sometime very soon, you're going to be creating double integrals for yourself that you will be integrating yourself using this method of partial integration. And there are a few things to keep in mind as you are setting up your iterated double integrals, where if your iterated double integral doesn't satisfy the syntax warnings, what you have written is definitely incorrect. It is a sign that you have made a mistake in your work somewhere. So, the first syntax warning, the outer limits of integration, the ones on the limits of the integral symbol on the outside, should always be constants. Only numbers are allowed, neither x nor y is allowed, never, as the limits of the outer limits of the outer integration. There is also restriction on the inner limits of integration. They are allowed to be constants, and they are allowed to be functions of the outer variable, but they are not allowed to be functions of the inner variable. Let me show you one example of a nonsense iterated integral. Something has definitely gone wrong when someone tried to create this thing. This is definitely wrong. And the problem is that this outer limit of integration here, this is not constant. This is not constant. This is an x. So this integral is definitely wrong. A mistake has definitely been made setting up this integral. Because if it is set up correctly, it will always satisfy these two conditions. Now, let's give you a few more examples of nonsense iterated integrals. For example, another one might be the integral from 0 to 5, the integral from, let's say, x to y of f of xy dy dx. This is also nonsense. This integral is also definitely incorrect. And the problem is this limit right here. For the inner limit of integration, the limits are only allowed to be constants or functions of the outer variable. So here, the outer variable is x. So that means that the limits could contain numbers, the limits could contain x's, but the limit should definitely not contain y, because y is the inner variable and not the outer variable. So this is not a constant or function of x. And that is what is nonsense about this integral. So please do keep these in mind. If you're working a problem and the problem requires you to create an iterated integral, and the one that you create is violating one of these two properties, there's definitely a mistake in your work somewhere. So you've got to go back, and that's a sign to go back and check your work.